All right, well, it's 5:32, so I think I'm going to get us started. We've got over 60 people in the room. I think we have a few more joining us every time I look up, but welcome. My name is Marie Williams, and I'm a member of the Volunteer Board of Directors for the Colorado Women's Hall of Fame. And on behalf of myself, our board chair, Barb Beckner, our executive director, Beth Barella, our founder, ML Hansen, who I was just speaking with, and everyone here at the hall, I want to welcome you to our fireside chat presented by Cable Labs, and we'll be talking about a new era of politics. For anyone who doesn't know, although I suspect everyone here does know, March is Women's History Month, and we here at the Hall are so proud to serve our mission of celebrating and sharing the enduring contributions of Colorado's distinctive women. Part of what we do is make sure that Colorado women are written into history. And you can help us continue writing them into history by making a donation or becoming a sponsor of one of our events like this. You can see the QR code that's over here up on your screen to make a donation, or you can contact our executive director, Beth, to talk about other ways you might be able to support the hall. Tonight's event is the second virtual event we're hosting in 2021 and part of two new series that we launched this year. All of these events this year give you the opportunity to hear directly from two or three of our inductees, and selfishly, I get the chance to talk to all of them, so it's really fun. Our 2021 Fireside Chat series is presented by Cable Labs, and we thank them for their support of the hall. Our thanks also go to our Grit and Grace sponsor for tonight, the Betcher Foundation, and Judi is a board member at the Betcher Foundation. Also, thanks to our longtime media sponsor, Denver 7, and to our two Friends of the Hall sponsors, Mint Financial and Janice Henderson Investors. You can read more about all of them in the virtual program that you should have received by email. We're going to pause now for just a moment to hear a word from our presenting sponsor, Cable Labs.
Hi, we're Cable Labs. We were formed by the companies in our industry to build the technologies you use today. From the infrastructure which delivers internet and TV to homes across the world, and even the future 5G service you will enjoy in your smart car. In fact, over 500 million people around the globe use our technologies every day. We collaborate within and beyond our walls to define the future. At Cable Labs, we connect the world so you can connect with yours. Hi, we...
And again, we'll say thanks to Cable Labs for being our presenting sponsor for all three of our Fireside Chat events this year. This evening's event features not just two, but three of our amazing inductees into the Colorado Women's Hall of Fame. The two you've already seen us advertise as being here with us tonight are Gail Schoettler and Judi Wagner. And our third inductee is LaRae Orullian, who will be introducing Gail and Judi in just a moment. So I get to introduce LaRae. LaRae Orullian is a 1988 inductee into the Colorado Women's Hall of Fame. She was in high school when she got a summer job as a bank messenger girl. Within 2 weeks, she was promoted to coin wrapper, then to file clerk, then to loan processor, and on up until she headed the FHA's Title I department. Wanting to continue that success, she decided to venture to Wall Street to become a businesswoman. But lucky for us, on her way to New York, she stopped in the first city of significant size, which was Denver. She began as a secretary in a bank, but planned to make her move to bank officer. To do so, she needed to attend banking school, but banks mostly sent men there. LaRae spent 14 years in night school until she graduated with three certificates from the American Bankers Association, American Institute of Banking. And in 1969, the National Association of Bank Women awarded her its first scholarship to the Graduate Banking School at Ohio State University. She used her vacations to spend 2 weeks a year on campus and did the rest by correspondence, something we've all gotten used to in the last year, but was very uncommon back then. LaRae graduated in the top 5% of her class with a degree in real estate finance. In 1976, several women in Denver decided to form the Women's Bank, including Judi and Gail. LaRae became the first president and CEO of that women's bank. She went on to hold the highest position of any woman in the banking industry. And Women's Bank in Denver was a leader among the nation's minority banks with an outstanding record in growth, profits, and service to women and small businesses. A devoted community activist, LaRae helps provide educational seminars for women in banking. She was the board chair for Girl Scouts of the United States. She sat on the International Board of Directors for Girl Guides and Girl Scouts. She's chaired the boards of Frontier Airlines, Colorado Blue Cross Blue Shield, and Rocky Mountain Administrative Services Corporation. She has also known our other two inductees for more than 40 years. So we're delighted to have LaRae introduce both Gail Schoettler and Judi Wagner. LaRae, take it away.
My goodness, what an introduction, Marie. Thank you very much. I just would like to add my welcome to everyone who's on today. What a wonderful thing that Zoom does is get us together in ways that we never had hoped or even thought about in years past. And congratulations to the Women's Hall of Fame and to ML Hansen, who I've known for many, many years, that started this great organization that now is spending wonderful time, not only bringing a lot of us together on these special events, but also getting a chance to know each other better. It's really an honor for me to be able to introduce you to two people this afternoon. Most of us know women who go by their first name only. And when you think of those women, it's probably Cher and Oprah. Well, in Colorado, we have our two women also, and that's Gail and Judi. They don't need to go by last names. Everybody knows them because they've been so involved in our community and have done so many wonderful, grateful, wonderful things. I keep using the word wonderful because it's kind of inclusive of what they've done. Judi Buck Wagner, has been in Denver for a long time. She not only had her own investment firm, Wagner Investment Company, where she did a great deal of wealth management, and she taught many of her clients how to manage their own money and made many dollars for them. But she's been active. She was, of course, one of the founders of the Women's Bank that's already been mentioned. And she's the kind of person that whenever people are in trouble, there's arguments going on or different opinions, Judi can step into the role and calm people down and make a lot of sense out of it. So she brings people together in a beautiful way. And I think this evening we'll get to learn more about her skills. So she was an outstanding businesswoman in Denver and in Colorado. Gail, on the other hand, decided to go the political route. And I think that was a little prompting of Judi also. Mm-hmm. She ran for Douglas County School Board. She went on to be our state treasurer. And during those two terms, a state treasurer, she modernized that whole section of our department in Colorado and did many, many things that upgraded the treasurer's office. Then she moved to lieutenant governor and did an outstanding job in that position. She also ran for governor. And I think if we'd had electing women back in those days, she only needed a few more votes to be named our governor. But we didn't have electing women. We didn't get to spur people on to vote for her. She lost by just a narrow margin. I've known, as you mentioned, Gail and Judi since 76 when we were founding the Women's Bank. And I can't say enough about the things they've done in our community, not just for women, but they brought a lot of men to the forefront and helped them understand the trials and tribulations that women in business and women in the political world have faced. So my hat's off to both of them. And now I'm really looking forward to hear them tell the story of electing women.
Great.
So I'll turn it over to Judi and Gail.
Let me jump in for just a minute, LaRae. Thank you again for introducing them. It's really special to have all three of you here. Let me give you two housekeeping notes, everyone, before we get started here. The first is that I've gotten messages from a couple people that they're not seeing our speakers. What you should see is four panels with me, LaRae, Gail, and Judi, largest on your screen. If you're not seeing that, check the upper right-hand corner in Zoom and put it in speaker view. That should work, so you'll be able to see the four of us as we're talking. And then the last note is, we'd love to have your questions for our speakers. So if you think of questions you'd like to ask one of them, you can type them in the chat box to me. I'm going to fix that setting to make sure it only comes to me. And I will pass those on to our speakers as the opportunity arises. So with that, I'll just say one word that we're designing tonight's program to go with our theme of new era of politics. We thought about different ways to do that. And one of the ways to do that is to talk about the dynamics of women and money and politics and the significance of Kamala Harris having been elected our first woman vice president. So we were so fortunate to have Gail and Judi as inductees in the hall who founded Electing Women, the organization that you've heard LaRae reference already. So why don't we just jump right in and talk about Electing Women since we're already there. Gail, I'll let you start, I guess.
Well, thank you. Thank you. And LaRae, I think this is a discussion, a three-way discussion, LaRae. So I want you to join in because we've done this. We've been together for so many years. It's kind of the three of us. And I'm really, really excited to be part of this with Judi and LaRae. And Marie, thank you so much for getting us all together. So Electing Women, Judi and I would never have run for office without Judi Wagner. One of the things I would say to any woman who is thinking about running for office is find your Judi, because you can't do it without her, especially a woman can't do it without a Judi. And so I ended up running for statewide office because of her. She was my finance chair when I ran for governor. And at the end of that, and I lost by, I don't know, like 5,500 votes. At the end of that race, when I had lost, Judi and I got together and we said, we have got to do something to get women to be more supportive of women. I tell this story a lot. I had had women who I knew had loads of money, and I would ask them for $1,000, which was the maximum contribution. And they'd say, oh, you know, I just can't afford to do that, but I'll write you a $50 check. And I would know the woman was wearing a $5,000 suit. So I knew she could do better than that. So Judi and I thought, well, women aren't going to be really winning these races, running for governor or running for the Senate, unless women support women. And that's how Electing Women got started 21 years ago, Judi?
Yes. Now,
I think 21 years ago, we decided that we would get women together in Colorado and ultimately, hopefully around the country, and support women running for governor in the U.S. Senate financially. And Judi, why don't you talk about how we did that?
Well, bottom line is that we tried to figure out the most attractive woman we could possibly get to Denver. And that was a challenge because most of the women that were running for Senate or for governor had really restricted budgets. And we needed to find somebody close. And it turned out that Heidi Heitkamp was running in North Dakota, and her trip would not be very expensive, and she could get here pretty easily. And she had a very interesting story. And so we asked Heidi to come, and she was just the most magnificent candidate. She arrived, and we had invited as many of our friends that we thought would write a $1,000 check to my house for lunch. And we managed to get enough to say to Heidi, okay, we promise you $25,000 if you'll come to Denver and have lunch with some of our friends. And so she came, and she had this amazing afro, bright red afro. And she was absolutely engaging. We just couldn't believe that she wouldn't be elected. She was so articulate and knew the issues so well. And people left that event really excited about supporting a woman, even though they had to write a big check to be in her presence. We were thinking, you know, if you have to write a $1,000 check, you're going to really pay attention and listen to the candidate and really appreciate them. And that's what happened, because mostly Heidi was just a magnificent magnet. She drew such a great crowd. She was running ahead. She wasn't ahead yet, but she was running very strongly. And she went back home and had a diagnosis of breast cancer. And so her standing in the polls dropped 30% overnight. And so she lost. And she then went through all the steps with breast cancer and emerged healthy. And so then she ran again about, I think, Gail, I don't remember if it was 6 or 8
10 years ago. Yeah, because she served one term in the Senate.
She then ran for the Senate and was elected and did a fabulous job. And she was the first person we had. But it set the climate that if we could bring in astoundingly bright women to talk to groups of people, they would want to hear from her. And it was like a real one-on-one event. So you know, if you were at that first luncheon with Heidi, you were her friend forever. She would take your phone call always. She would always let you know if she's in Denver. She just was the kind of person that you wanted to believe was going to make a difference in our national politics. And she did, and has, and will continue to. I'll bet we have another opportunity to support Heidi. But that was the idea, Marie, to have small gatherings of people, primarily women, who would be supporting women for top elective office. Because definitely we need to do the bottom-up process. We need to get a lot of women running at all levels, but we needed to have the top down. We needed to have women in the Senate and women in governorships. So we started to just invite one or two women a year. This started in 2020. And I think that year we had 2000, right. And so 20 years later, here we are in 2020. But so we started with the first event and had one or two events. And I can't remember exactly, Gail, but then the next year we had a few more, and the next year we had a few more. But the whole time, the idea was to get a small cadre of women that would come to these events so that they got to know these leaders and could pass the word about how strong they were.
I'd love to hear you talk about the impact that your electing women group has had. I know we've talked about it spreading to other states, but also I'd love to get a sense of how many different women candidates you've worked with in 20 years.
Okay, let me go back just a little bit and say that when we started this, what we wanted was for women to have power. We wanted women in elected office. We wanted women to be making the policy decisions that affected women and families and men and the whole country. We wanted women to have power, and we wanted women to have access to the halls of power. So one of the ways you do that, a key way to do it, whether you like the money in politics or not, is you raise money. And if you write a big check, and $1,000 is a very big check, you will have access. The person you write the check to will return your phone call. So women have access, will have access by raising money and writing checks and electing women to the halls of power. And that's what we need, because we care about issues that are often different from what we see the men spending their time on. So that was very important to us. But I think the impact has been huge. Our only screen is choice. A woman has to be pro-choice. That has meant that they've been Democratic women, because it's difficult for Republican pro-choice women to get nominated for offices. But we have supported all of the Democratic women in the Senate with one exception. And there are only 9 women governors, and all of the women governors who are pro-choice. And that's a really big deal. And now we have 16 groups around the country also raising money for women. We would like to have at least one electing women group in every state, so that women in every state know that they have a powerful source of support behind them. And so that women around the country see this as a movement. This is a movement to elect women. This is Judy's term. It's a movement to elect women, because women, doesn't matter which party you are, women tend to vote more on causes and issues that matter to women and families, whether it is healthcare or economic benefits or climate change. Women vote more on issues that matter to women and families, and that's why we want them there.
We had a great question come in from one of our audience members She asked, was there a time when you thought electing women wasn't working or wasn't going to work? And if so, can you talk about that and what you did about it?
Judy, you take that one.
Gail gives me all the good ones. You know what? I don't think we've had that. We've grown since we started, and it's been incremental. It hasn't been huge. Every year we hope to add about 10 to 20% more people. Some years we have great, bountiful, you know, people joining us, and other years it's slower. It just has been, you know, kind of a steady, keep trying, keep going, just to, you know, be aware of who might be interested and include them and help them understand what's going on.
Is it fair to say that you've grown it slowly to make sure that it could sustain, or?
I think that's true.
We wanted to grow it as fast as we could. It just happened that way.
Okay. Yeah, but
we would like to have a million women all over the country writing big checks to women so that women would always win.
Yeah.
And Gail's our pusher, obviously. And I'm the one that counts the money. So that's how this works.
But you're very pushy too, so it's two of us.
No, we both are. We both are very anxious to get lots more women all over the country. And we're working on that. We have this amazing person, Heather Lurie, who has been key in the Electing Women Alliance nationally and has gotten us in front of huge numbers of people. And what we're really trying to do is make it a grassroots thing in every single state. That's our goal. And thanks to Heather, we're making progress on that.
And you, we talked on Monday, was that Monday? Yeah, among the four of us. How did this year's fundraising compare to prior years in terms of electing our first woman vice president?
Well, it's an absolute thrill to have the first woman vice president. I wish we also had already had a woman president, because it's been a very long time and we haven't ever had a woman president, and there are countries around the world who surprised me to have had a woman chief executive. So we are thrilled that Kamala Harris is the vice president. We're very excited. I know she's, and I think, let's see, Beth, you know a little bit about what's happening on Tuesday. She's going to be coming to Denver, but we worked really hard. We raised in Colorado, we raised over $800,000 for Kamala Harris, and the Electing Women Alliance, our 16 groups, raised over $3 million for her in an event that we did. So we want women running this country, and we're so excited to have the vice president. And we do hope very much that we will be around to watch the inauguration of the first woman president.
Great. Well, I have another question that came in. One of our audience members said first that they love hearing from pushy women. So that's great. But the question was, how do we elect more women at all levels? So I know electing women is focused on gubernatorial and senator campaigns, but how do we do it at all levels?
Go ahead, Judy.
All right, just
you go ahead. You go
how
ahead.
Do we do it at all levels? Well, there's our wonderful groups that have started. One is called Emerge, that helps women get trained, that are able to start at whatever level they're interested in. And they've got a great program nationally. There's a group called Ignite that is working hard to help women of every level get started. And so we'll give a list of those contacts that you can pass out if anyone wants to have them. But that's where we have to start. Gail has talked a lot about, you know, running for school board. That's very often the place that people get started, because it's something close to their hearts, having their children in schools and being able to be there to help them improve. So there are lots of options.
So I'm glad you mentioned
Colorado. Colorado actually is really the forefront of electing women in state and local offices. We have a majority in the state legislature. We have very, very strong statewide office holders who are women, have had them. And one of the things we do with electing women is every time we do an event, we ask a young woman running for one of the down ticket offices for either, you know, school board or city council or the state legislature, we ask them to introduce our candidate so that electing women sponsors get to know who some of the candidates are. And then all of us support women in other ways, writing checks, doing events for them, spending a lot of time talking to them about strategy and so on. So we are really, really excited about how strong women in Colorado are at all levels.
So we thought it would be fun to ask our audience a couple questions here, and we this discussion of Emerge and Ignite, I think, is a great time to ask. I'm going to put up a poll question, and you'll be answering anonymously, but we want to know how many of you in our audience are interested in running for political office at any level. So you can answer anonymously, but we want to see what you have to say so we can talk to you about it a little bit. So just put this up for a few seconds so you can just click a button and log in your answer.
Say yes, we want you to run.
We've got two yes imminently so far. Oh, some of us have already served in elected office. That's right. We forgot to mention that. Of course, Gail has, but some of our audience have as well. So that's wonderful. All right, it looks like answers have mostly come through, so I'm going to stop it here. But we have two yes eminently's and 10 maybe one days. So I think that's good news for us.
That's great.
Yeah, and we had a comment too that a couple of our audience members would love to have that list of resources. So Gail and Judy, maybe you can email that to Beth and we can get it out to folks after our program, because
absolutely.
Yeah, we want to connect with people who are interested. Let me go on to Women's Bank for just a moment. I'm sure we'll end up coming back to electing women, but I did want to talk about Women's Bank for just a minute because we had such an interesting discussion earlier this week about the dynamics of women and money and partially how it relates to politics, but also just how it relates to our society. So Women's Bank started in 1976-77. Why did you decide to do that? And I'll start with you, Judy.
Well, I was working in the investment management business, and I was in charge of analyzing banks in Colorado. And I was working for a big investment management firm then, and it was impossible to even get an appointment as a security analyst with some of the CEOs. They just didn't think there was any reason for a woman to be interviewing them. And so it turned out that it made a lot of sense to me to try to get some awareness of how powerful women could be in influencing results for banking. And that's really what got me started in it. Just like, you know, women were not able to get their own credit cards. The Equal Credit Opportunity Act had not yet been passed until 1974. And I was working in that industry well before that. And so it was just discouraging and really obviously sexist that there was no way to make any headway within banking. So that's what got us started, wanting to get a bank. And Gail and I were part of the founding group of the organization that ultimately was able to hire this incredible banker named LaRae Orullian, who actually made this work. So we got a national charter, which we were turned down. Well, no, we weren't turned down. We decided not to go for a state charter because it was a whole good old boys banking board. And so we went for a national charter and managed, thanks to a woman named Betty Friedman, to entice a woman named Mary Roebling, who is the head of the Trenton Trust in New Jersey, to stop on her way out to California from New Jersey to meet the girls in Denver that were trying to start a bank. And Mary was going out to visit her astrologist and get a reading. And so she got a good reading on her way back and stopped and said, okay, I'll help you. And it's a great story. It's a fun story. But the bottom line is that LaRae was willing to take a big risk to help the women and a few men. We had 50 founders and 45 of them were women and 5 of them were men. And LaRae was willing to take the risk to come to work with us once we had preliminary approval from the Comptroller of the Currency. So the story from there goes to LaRae, and I don't know if LaRae wants to talk anymore about it, but you just
I want, I want LaRae to tell everyone the story of the first day that the bank opened, because that's such a great story.
Well, it really was a wonderful story. And I was taking a session with Drs. Hennig and Jardim, who were the women from Harvard that wrote the book, The Managerial Woman. And they came out to Denver to interview me. And during those sessions, they said, you need to take risks. Well, Judy's group came along. And one of the things I always do is, from my accounting background, do a T account, where you put the pluses and the minuses, the good, the bad, the yeses, the noes, the credits, the debits, and so on. And it kept coming out kind of even, because it was going to be a risk to leave a position where I was executive vice president. But finally, I took that risk, and with it came much reward. The fun thing was that this group of founders worked together, and we taught each other a great deal, not only about banking, but just about life in general. And so we trained everyone. We had been, by word of mouth, we sold our stock, sold it out 100% immediately. A lot of women owned stock for the first time in their lives. But that big day, it turned out to be 7/7/77. And we opened the doors, and down 17th Street, we opened our doors in Equitable Building down 17th Street, where all these people with checks and money in their hands waiting to open accounts. And we had trained all of our board members so that they could sit down at desks and open these accounts. So we had everyone working very diligently. And when we struck a balance that first night, we had taken in $1 million. And so it was a very, very exciting day. And it's a fun story I love to tell. Not only that, we made a profit our first full month in business, almost unheard of in the banking world, but we did it, and we continued to progress. Every month after that, we took in another $1 million. So in the first year, we were a $12 million bank plus our capital.
That's great. So I hadn't asked you this before, but were there other women's banks around the country at that time? Or were we the first to do it in Colorado?
There was a women's bank being organized in New York City, and they started out pretty well, but they got into serious trouble by making bad loans. And fortunately, there were other women's groups, there were savings and loans and investment groups that started women's bank, but we were kind of the shining star.
That's great. Judi, I know you have a comment to make about LaRae making loans.
Well, LaRae was a classic loan maker. I mean, she wanted you to absolutely give her everything that you owned and to sign a lifelong commitment to banking with you. And I don't know what else I was going to say about that. But
She
never did make a bad loan. She always collected eventually. Now, there was a time in 1980-81 when, you remember, interest rates were up to 18% or something like that. And she had a property that was holding down this loan up in Vail. And I think it was a cliff in Vail that was the property. I don't know. It was just, one of those random collaterals. And she managed to collect on that loan. It took a couple years, but she did it.
Okay, so I want to add something to that, because LaRae is a very special person and was a particularly unique loan officer. She never gave up, and that's sort of maybe the most important thing, but she also took the time to counsel people when she thought they might be getting into trouble or when they were in trouble. She would call them in and talk to them about it and talk through how they could manage the loan, how they could manage their business so that they would be successful. And I don't think there were very many bankers who took the time that LaRae took to make sure that every single one of her customers had the best of her knowledge and of the bank's knowledge. And I think that was one reason, LaRae, you've always been so successful.
Thank you. I think that's illustrated in a lot of our customers who didn't say they banked at the Women's Bank. They belonged to the Women's Bank. And so many of our clients and customers felt that they were part of a wonderful group. It was a team. It really was a team.
And I asked you if all of those customers on the first day were women, and the answer is no, right? We had men who wanted to help their wives and daughters and just believed in it as well. So I think that was great. this idea of LaRae sitting down and talking to people who are going to take out loans about how to manage money, you know, that's a, I mean, that's a concept that we all hope that we have in lots of different environments, you know, mentors helping us. And is that a piece that you bring into electing women at all as well? You know, in addition to raising money, is there some think tank, some lessons learned that you get a chance to share with folks?
Hey, Gail.
Oh, yeah. Well, many, many lessons learned. I think if you're a woman starting out in politics, and I think both Judy and I do a lot of sort of mentoring of young women who are getting into politics, broadening your circle is maybe one of the most important things. So what the reality of winning elections is, it's money and votes. And you have to be able to raise money and have to be willing to raise money, but you also have to have people want to vote for you. And that means that you build these big, broad connections as large as you can, so that when you want to run for office, you have people who step up and say, I'd really like to help you, and do help you and introduce you to their friends and help you raise money. So I think a lesson for anybody who's going to be successful in politics is, be involved in your community, be involved as broadly as you can, get to know as many people as you can, and really think hard about why it is you want to run. And here again, I think women are really different about this. Every woman I know who's ever run for public office has been passionate about an issue or a couple of issues. That is not the case for everybody who runs for office. I see an awful lot of young men who stand up and say, I'm wonderful, here I am, of course you want to vote for me. And I hear women say, oh gee, you know, if I want to be in the legislature, I've got to go to law school and I've got to do this and I've got to do that. And I say, no, 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 you just have to care really deeply about something and talk about it, because when you talk about something that you really care about, you're passionate and people believe in you. So I think sorting through what really matters to you and knowing why you want to run, and then really fighting hard for what you believe in, is extremely important. If you look at the women who are in high public office, I look at Patty Murray, who was at one point on the school board in Washington. Patty Murray, who's probably the most powerful woman in the United States Senate. And she ran because she had a disabled child and she was unhappy with the way the school board was running things for children with special needs. And so she went from there, and she ran for the Senate wearing her tennis shoes, because she said, I'm the mother in tennis shoes, and I care about public education, and I care about making sure that children with special needs get the education that they need. And she's been very passionate about that. And thank goodness we have her, because she also is a woman who stands up for women, stands up for women's rights, and always votes for in the best interests of women.
Can I add something, Marie?
Yeah.
I would like to point out that we have a woman on this Zoom that is going to be running for office someday, I hope. And I just want to highlight that she's here and on it. And her name is Sarah Godlewski. She's lived here in Colorado.
Sarah. Yay!
I know, it's so great. And she is definitely, she's the treasurer of the state of Wisconsin, and she is a great treasurer. They have, you know, definitely challenges in Wisconsin. And we're just so glad to have you, Sarah. So give everybody a wave.
That's
great. Sarah was an electing woman sponsor, a member of Electing Women when she was living in Colorado. When she moved to Wisconsin, She knew everybody. She ran for office. She took a lot of risks. She ran for office. Nobody thought she could win. She won. And Sarah, I'm hoping that you're going to be running for governor one of these days.
Well, you might be hearing from me, Gail, because there is a senator called Ron Johnson that's up in 2020.
Oh, you're going to run against him?
So yes. You might be hearing more about that from me.
All right. Well, you don't forget about Electing Women. We're there for you.
We want to start one in Wisconsin.
Yeah. But this
give us your best friends. What?
Well, and I just want to say, I mean, you guys have been mentors for me, and I would not have been able to run for state treasurer and move back home if it wasn't for Gail and Judy, both of you, like, inspiring me to do this. So I am so grateful, and your reach which is not only setting the stage in Colorado, but it is viral beyond those walls. So thank you for everything that you've done and continue to do for women, because it is life-changing.
Thank you for being here. We really appreciate it.
That's great.
Yeah, we're going to come to Wisconsin and help you start a group in Wisconsin.
Right. I think there's a very good friend on that lives and that had grown up in Wisconsin that knows a lot of people there. I'm not sure if she's on right now, but Steph Harvey is somebody that we need to have you get to know.
And Kristen Robbins.
And Kristen Robbins, that's right. So we've got a team already.
Before I take Sarah off the spotlight here, one of our audience members did ask, what can they do to help you? So
there she is.
If you want a moment to tell us a website people can go to or anything, we'd be happy to hear it.
Yeah, I guess my I'm just at sarahforwisconsin.com right now, but hopefully we'll be able to share more with all of you guys in the near future.
People can follow you there. Thanks so much, Sarah. And talking about reach beyond Colorado, we had another question come in asking about reach to women of color. So Kamala Harris is not just our first woman vice president, but Black woman, Indian American woman. And could you offer some thoughts about the impact of women of color in politics and any ways in which money and fundraising dynamics might be a little bit different for them?
Well, okay. So one of the best events we ever had, so exciting, was an event we hosted for Stacey Abrams, who was then running for governor of Georgia. And of all the women in the country right now, she's probably at the forefront of women changing politics in the country. As we see voter suppression laws, I mean, 250 of them all over the country, the woman who is going to be fighting that most effectively is going to be Stacey Abrams. She's going to show us the way to make sure that everybody has the opportunity to vote. And I think she's going to be running for governor again. But I think it's harder for women of color. It's harder for women to run for office because there still is this bias against women in high public office, less so for local offices. But it's much harder for women of color. And yet there are incredible women who are running all over the country. In fact, we're going to be hosting one of them very soon, Senator Catherine Cortez Masto, who is senator from Nevada, Hispanic woman. And I think that there are two women in Virginia, two African-American women who are running for governor against a white man who's going to be really formidable, but good for them. And one of the things that we try to do is always support women of color running for offices in Colorado. And we always support the women of color who are running for top offices around the country.
And I might add, there's a group called Higher Heights. You may have seen a big ad in the New York Times a couple days ago mentioning that there's never been a Black woman senator, never a Black woman governor, and long list of all the women that have been in office. But it's a national organization that's working hard to elect more women to top offices. So we're trying to have some events in common with them. But if you want to do more work in that area, you check out Higher Heights.
Great. Can we talk for a minute about what impact do you think having Kamala Harris in office will have in terms of opportunities for other women, either making fundraising easier, making it seem more realistic in people's minds that we can have women in these high offices? How do you think that might play out for us?
I think it's huge. You know, when I was running for office 20 some odd years ago, there weren't any women. There were a couple of women senators, there had been a couple of women governors, but there weren't any women out there who were really visible and who could point the way and say, well, here's what you need to know, and here's how you deal with this particular bias or this particular problem. Kamala Harris, well, first of all, she's so warm and personable, people just want to be around her. But every little African-American girl, every little Latina girl, every little white girl is going to look at her when she's 6 or 7 or 5 or 6 and say, I could be there too. I could do that too. And I look at little girls and think, what a brilliant future we have if, if all those little girls decide, I can be successful like Kamala Harris, I can run for office, I can run a company, I can be a senator, I can be a governor, I can be a president, I can do this. And I mean, it's not just little girls, it's going to be young women, girls, teenagers, young women, older women, who are all going to look at her and say, if she can do it, maybe I've got the chance and I'm going to give it a try. But I love the idea that particularly since little girls, when they start to hit, say, 10 or 11, start to feel as though they're not as capable, or they're told they're not as capable, they won't be saying that anymore, because here's Kamala Harris showing them the way and showing them a woman who's powerful and strong and capable, and they can do it too.
I cannot resist the urge to plug Girl Scouts here. LaRae was
sure?
The national board chair, and Girl Scouts Research Institute has numbers that show that participating in the Girl Scout leadership experience help diminish that effect that happens at 10 and 11 as girls are starting to lose confidence in their own abilities to lead and to do things. So, you know, to anyone who has daughters or younger girls, you know, get them in Girl Scouts to help this too. I've got other Girl Scouts on here saying yay. So, but yeah, I mean, I think we've seen a lot of that in different ways. We got a hard question here. Gonna need some speculation. When do you think Colorado might be able to elect its own woman U.S. Senator or governor?
That's what we're working on.
We should be able to do it now. We had a fabulous woman running for governor a couple of years, 2 years ago, Carrie Kennedy. She would have been a really fantastic governor. I think a woman is going to be elected governor or senator very soon. But it's going to take women saying, I'm going to vote for a woman. It's time for a woman. I'm tired of having only old white men representing me and my, or young white men representing me in Colorado. And I am only going to vote for a woman this time. I just want you all to know that. I'm going to only vote for a woman. I'm going to write a check to a woman, and I'm going to be working really hard for a woman. Okay, guys, I want you all to know that.
Hey, Marie, this is ML. Can I just weigh in on a follow-up to what you were talking about with Girl Scouts?
Sure.
I'd like to talk about how the Colorado Women's Hall of Fame, I convened this group, and we now have a Girl Scout patch that can be earned online, which has been great during the pandemic. And so we've had over 400 girls who have earned the Colorado Women's Hall of Fame Girl Scout of Colorado patch, including troops from three other states.
Yeah. That's been, I'm a Girl Scout troop leader. I don't think I said that when I jumped in and said, go Girl Scouts, but
I'm so happy with what we've done with this.
Yeah, I think it's a great way that we're working on the mission of the Hall of Fame by sharing all of our inductees, including Gail and LaRae and Judi, with all of these other women and young girls in Girl Scouts, just to educate them, to inspire them. And I've been getting tons of comments from folks about how great your stories are and how inspiring this is. So I think that's, you know, another way in which we try to encourage people and motivate them to do great things on their own. So thank you, ML, for chiming in with that. Let's see, Judi, I'm gonna pick on you. Did you have any thoughts on women governor or senator in Colorado?
Oh, absolutely. We've got so many qualified candidates. And you look at, you know, the work that we've done in our state legislature with the women that have been in charge in the last, say, 10 years, any one of them would be a wonderful candidate. They just could step into the ring and go for it. So what we have to do is convince them of that. And how we do that is get more people to want to have a woman governor. And, you know, truthfully, we love our men. They do a great job, but they always are pushing their way into the front. And so we've got to get organized in advance to support a woman that can, you know, now start running for that office, not wait until the next year or the year after. So I could name a number of names, but I don't think they'd appreciate that. But I think there are a lot of very qualified people.
So for anyone who's listening who thinks, and I've heard a couple of these comments too, who thinks, yes, I'm not ready to run for office, but I want to support women who are running for office for all the reasons we've talked about, what's the best way for them to get involved in with electing women or some other organization?
Well, let us know if you're interested. I'm available at judyw43@aol.com. Just send me an email and say
gmail.com.
Well, I've got two things, Gail. I know I've got two addresses, Gail.
Oh.
So the AOL one works the best for electing women. So send me an email and send Gail an email.
Or send me an email. Mine's easy, gailschoettler@msn.com. And let me, I just want to throw out a couple, I know we're going to be short of time, a couple other things. Between the time I ran for governor and the time the next woman ran for governor, it was 20 years. Between the time Dottie Lamb ran for the U.S. Senate and the next woman ran for the U.S. Senate was 22 years. Part of what we have to do as women is go say to women, you are so qualified. I want you to run and I'm going to get behind you and I'm going to help you. I'm going to help you raise money. I'm going to help you organize. Ask women to run and tell them that you'll support them. It's crazy that a state like Colorado, which had 3 women speakers of the House in a row, has not had, took 20 years to have another woman run for governor.
Now I'll have to tell another story. When Gail and I were working on the bank together, one day we were walking down 17th Street and she tells me that I accosted her and said, you need to run for treasurer. And I don't think I accosted her, but I do believe I said to her, that would be a great thing for you to do. So, and I'll help you, I'll run, you know, I'll help your finance. And so find a partner. Get people, offer to be somebody's partner. Tell them that you'll help them. Somebody, you know, identify a candidate that's in the district that really needs some new blood. So say to somebody, let me help you run for X. And that will get it started. Now, we can talk forever about whether I accosted her or I just asked her nicely. But in fact, she got going on it. So
get
a friend.
Yeah. hey, while we're talking about donating money to politics, I should also mention the hall because I got a message that a couple people have donated during our program. So thank you very much for helping us support the hall, and we really appreciate that.
Good work.
I have, before we kind of wrap up, Gail, I want to ask you this question that came in. I don't know if you thought about it, but the question was, what were you willing to lose when you were running?
What was I willing to lose, or was I willing to lose?
What were you willing to lose? What did you give up? What were you willing to give up?
Oh, I gave up my life for 2 years. It's when you're running for a statewide office, especially for governor or senator, you are programmed all the time because you really have to get all over. You have to raise money, which takes a huge amount of time, and you have to get all over the state, which was the fun part. I loved traveling the state the whole time I was in public office. So you have to be willing to give up your personal time. And it's very hard if you have a young family. You have to, what I did is my kids weren't young, but I took them with me when I was campaigning. And my daughter was learning to drive. So when I was running for a state treasurer, she drove me a lot. It was quite terrifying, but and I think she's actually looking for this program tonight. You were a terrifying driver, Catherine. But I think you have to involve your family, because otherwise, and that's one thing I would never give up is my family, but I did give up my personal time, and it was worth it because it was such a rewarding thing to serve in public office, and it was really exciting. I mean, what a thrill to be, I think I was the first woman nominated by a major party to run for governor. What a thrill. What a thrill that was.
Yeah, great. Well, we appreciate you having done it. And I don't know if you know, but our last session, we talked to Dottie Lamb. So, I mean, we're just hitting all the high points here.
Yeah, you are.
Yeah. Last question for all three of you. We like to leave these events, you know, with people inspired and motivated and learning from all of you. So I want to ask you to share with us some nugget of wisdom. What advice do you have for women who are thinking about, you know, whether they're thinking about running for office, if they're just starting their career, or anything to sort of inspire us all to be our best?
All right, LaRae.
Oh, I get to go first. Wonderful. Yeah. Well, I already talked about my T account, and I kind of use that as a guideline to help me make major decisions. One of the important virtues, I think, is patience, because things just don't happen overnight, but we keep working at it. Finally, something will happen. I also think we need to be very flexible. You know, there's more than one path. There's more than one road to our destination. And I learned a lot about teamwork when I was heading up Girl Scouts, because you can do more, as you've talked about, getting a partner, getting support from other people. Teamwork is really, really important as you move through life and you have that support. It's not one of the things we used to say in Girl Scouts, it's not I, it's us, it's not me, it's we. And those are the kinds of things we need to think about. The final thing, and this comes from my mother, was to stay humble. Doesn't matter how far you go in life, stay humble, and prayer is important. But my mother always used to say, don't get too big for your own britches.
Yes. So, yes.
I think those are words of wisdom that have helped me. Thank you.
That's great. Gail, what about you?
Who's next?
You are.
Judy, you go.
You're up, Gail.
Okay. All right. Well, I think I'd say maybe three things. Most important is never give up. Never, 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 never give up. If I had nothing else to say, that's how I would leave it. Never give up. But I think the other thing, I would say a couple of other things maybe. Never trash another woman. When you're talking about her, I don't care whether you agree with her politically or any other way, never say anything bad about another woman. You can say, I don't like her policy, but there are plenty of people out there trashing women. Don't you be one of them. I think that women need to build up women, whether we agree with them or not, and listen to them and care about them. We do not need to take them apart. So never give up and speak kindly of women.
Great, thank you. Judy?
Well, you stole my line. Winston Churchill, of course, is the guy that said never, never, never give up. And I've got a pillow embroidered that says that. But that's the most important thing. Keep after it. But also trust yourself. Believe in yourself. Do not worry when somebody tells you that you're crazy or you're wrong or why are you doing this. Just trust yourself. And that to me means, you know, go ahead and ask anybody you can think of to help you. It's easy, even if it feels weird. Just go ahead and try. And the final thing is enjoy the process. Yes. Just try to make it fun, make it yours. Be strong in who you are and cry at Safeway openings if you have to.
Well, we are about out of time here. So Gail, Judi, and LaRae, I want to thank all of you again for being here with us tonight. It's been a treat for all of us to hear from you directly. You're all women who live amazing lives that can inspire all of us. So thank you. Talking about, one of you mentioned the path to success not being a straight line. It's an awesome segue for me. Oh, LaRae's holding up a book of the Women's Bank.
I did mean to tell everyone that, again, Judy's leadership, we have now a book that's written about the history of the Women's Bank. And it's really exciting because they're going to do a little Zoom on it on the 20th of this month that people could tune into. But this is a story of many women getting together and moving to a very successful story. And so I just want you to think about it's being done by the Women's History Museum, right, Judy?
Yes, Colorado. It's part of History Colorado.
Yes.
Great. So March 20th, we'll find some
yes,
more information
March 20th.
On that in case people Great. Are interested in that as well. And our next virtual event for the hall will be another Author's Corner on April 28th. It's called Over, Under, Around, and Through. And we'll be talking about a book that two of our inductees are in the process of writing, where they have taken this time of COVID to do a ton of Zoom interviews with other inductees. So they're working on gathering the collected wisdom of all of our inductees and talking about their paths to success. Excuse me. And the reason I thought it was such a nice point to make is that for none of them is the path a straight line. And that's where the title Over, Under, Around, and Through comes from. So I love that. We hope everyone will join us for that one. You can find the link to register either in your virtual program or on the hall's website at cogreatwomen.org. Hold on just one second. Okay. Last thing, I'd like to thank again our sponsors for tonight's event. Our Fireside Chat presenting sponsor is Cable Labs. Our Great and Grace sponsor was the Betcher Foundation. Our Denver longtime media sponsor, Denver 7.
Marie, can I help you?
You may.
Okay, so this has been absolutely wonderful. Marie deserves a big hand. Yeah. She is doing an amazing job on these events for us, so thank you so much. Our presenting sponsor is Cable Labs. We got a Grit and Grace sponsorship from Betcher Foundation. Judy's on the board of Betcher Foundation. And Marie just did away. We got Friends of the Hall sponsorships from Mint Financial and Janice Henderson. So thank you all for all of those attending from Mint Financial and Janice Henderson and Cable Labs and Betcher. And then our media sponsor remains Denver 7. Denver 7 has been a long-term supporter of Colorado Women's Hall of Fame. And we really, really appreciate their support. We also appreciate all of your support. This is fantastic when we get this number of guests that we get to share our messages with, because our mission is writing women into history.
And I am back, not coughing, but with not much of a voice. Thank you to a couple of you who said, you hope I'm okay, I'm fine. Just got some water down the wrong pipe. Thanks to all of you for being here. We hope to see you again. Good night. We're done. Thank you.
Good night. Thank you.
Night.